I'm bringing you back to the Adriatic. So today, Giulia and me are going to present some overview of what has been done on the so-called Cetina culture or Cetina phenomenon. Then we are going to see also the difference between these two sort of denomination for this white connectivity pattern. But let me start, for the few of you that maybe are not that familiar, with this so-called Cetina culture or Cetina phenomenon, which is a sort of this very complex and quite large connectivity pattern that we can recognize in the Adriatic and partially in the Ionian area, especially during the second half of the third millennium BC. So, besides this very characteristically decorated pottery, which stand out also in the Western Balkans, in which pottery is generally not decorated for this period, so we have also the association of this peculiar type of ceramic production with particularly funerary structures, that is tumuli. We have different types of architecture, different type of treatment of the body, so we have inhumation and cremation several times in the same tumulus. One of the characteristics, unfortunately, is that settlements are almost unknown. Most of the evidences that we have are coming or from caves or from few hill forts, but the evidence from hill forts is unfortunately limited to a handful of pots. So there are a lot of open questions, especially as regards this pattern of this Cetina culture, in which you can see here involves not only the Balkans but also Italy, and we can also expand this area to the Ionian Sea and involve southern Italy, of course, Sicily, Malta, and Peloponnese in this white connectivity pattern. So in the last year, our knowledge of this Cetina culture has really increased in all the areas under analysis. So here I show just two images in which we can see the large amount of sites known. So let's say that one is complementing the other, as you can see. This is not only because of new research and excavation, but mainly because many people are getting interested in this period and in this connectivity pattern phenomenon. So the review of all the excavation gave us really interesting data and enlarged the area, so the number of sites that we know. In particular, I want to point out the importance of this kind of revision in the so-called peripheral areas of the Cetina phenomenon. So especially, for example, in Bosnia, in Serbia, even in southern Serbia, and of course as regards Central Mediterranean, also Sicily, Malta, and Greece. So I'm just going to briefly sum up the most important steps in the research on the Cetina culture, which occurred in different time at different geographic and chronological scales and with different theoretical approaches. So let me start with Marović, who worked at a very local level, because during his lifetime work at the Split Museum, he excavated a huge amount of tumuli, maybe too many, so produced an enormous quantity of data. For this reason, especially the Cetina Valley, which was the center of his research, is very well known from the point of view of the quantity of archaeological assemblage. But it presents a lot of problems because, for example, some of those tumuli, we are not able to locate them today, so we don't know where they are, basically. I forgot to mention that he was the first one who recognized the presence of Cetina pottery in Italy during a conference. Another personality that really is a key one for the study of this Cetina culture is, of course, Govedarica, who approached this with a cultural historical theoretical framework, but he was very crucial in pointing out the extension of this phenomenon, which was not only limited to central Dalmatia, but it covered wide area from the Caput Adriae to Albania. From the 90s, of course, the dimension, the focus of the Cetina culture, and then that's why we are starting to talk about the Cetina phenomenon, was not in the Balkans, and more also because of historical circumstances, as you can imagine. In the 90s, there was the Yugoslav conflict, but there was also a renewed interest in these white connectivity patterns. So those Argonauts of the Balkans, which were navigating through the Adriatic in the search of probably metal, were then located in the white pattern of the Mediterranean Bronze Age. So for those of you who are familiar with the study on Cetina, maybe you see that somebody is missing, but Giulia and me, we thought that it's better to look at Filippo della Casa just directly, because then to put a picture here. And of course, he was working at both local level with the publication of the so-called princely tumul in Montenegro, and also of a large macro scale, publishing one of the first work in 1995. So slowly now we are recognizing, however, that this Cetina phenomenon has not only an inland dimension, but also, of course, an overseas one. But most important things, we are trying to see the both combined together. So the new, this is just a visualization of the different scales of the research on this Cetina culture, Cetina phenomenon. So where we are now, so we are at the point in which we have to go back in time and maybe start again to work on the inland aspect of the Cetina culture, and not just emphasizing this great narrative and this widespread overseas connectivity. So that's why we are combining our work, just trying to address these problems from different point of view. At a local scale, with the work of Helena Thomas in the Cetina Valley, so Helena is directing surveys there, and she got outstanding results trying to locate Cetina settlements, which, as I mentioned earlier, they're still unknown. Then we are also working, Giulia and me, both at local level, trying to work on old collection with unpublished material and trying to integrate all of the new data. And of course, Sascha Bodenbacher, who, as Philippe already mentioned, who has worked a lot on Palagruja, both from a ceramic point of view, connectivity, and latex, of course. So this is just a summary, just to visualize all the sites that we are trying to study again and to illustrate the work, our work, which is at a different scale. So by combining over land and seaborne connectivity patterns. Another problem that has recently in brought up by researchers, especially people who are working in Central Europe, is the connection between the belt pickers and Cetina, which is considered by Volker Heide as a sort of periphery. So the situation is not that clear, and also those aspects are not, those networks are not exactly comparable, because if on one side we have a belt picker package that maybe we can understand and trace, although declined in different ways, so there is no Cetina package at all. So some belt pickers elements are completely absent, like pottery, and the only things that we have are stone objects. This is also interesting to trace this relationship between Cetina and the belt pickers, because, sorry for this, is a very bad representation, but I just wanted to show you so how we have different types of connections with different belt pickers group. One is more Central European and internal, so but we, and this is mostly known for ceramics. We have two sites, Petro Varadin and Strikovac, in which so we have both pottery and stone elements, and on the coast we have no belt picker pottery at all. So another element that now is being emphasized, and I'm not going to repeat what Philip already said earlier, is the presence of raw material in form of dirt. So raw material procurement and the presence of Gargano lithics in the Adriatic. One thing that I want to stress is that we have at least two mines in the Gargano in which there are 30 millennium datings. So we know that also during the 30 millennium it was a quite lively frequentation of the area, as is also shown by the abundant material found on Palagruža. Palagruža is a very interesting case because we have a sort of a stop between these two shores with a quite a huge amount of material, both of course connected to belt pickers, this wrist guard, and Cetina pots. So new perspective, what are we trying to do now? We are trying to understand this Cetina phenomenon at different scales by applying different methodologies and by looking at the archaeological material from different points of view. And one of these is trying to understand pottery technology and pottery production and the cultural transmission between different areas. And for these reasons, we are adopting a scenoperatoire approach to the study of pottery. And in particular, we are collaborating with Silvia Micone of the University of Tübingen, and we are trying to cover the whole macro area in which we can find the Cetina. So these are the first analysis. Now the analysis on Greek material from Olympia and other sites is on its way. Another study that we are trying to that we are confident is going to give us many important information is the one with Marianne on isotopes, which is quite challenging. We encountered many difficulties, but I'm confident that it is going to produce good results. So to combine all those evidences together and see this pattern. So at present, as I mentioned, there are several projects ongoing. One is the CEVAS project, directed by Helena Thomas, in which Julia and me are collaborating. The other is an ADRIS, which is in which Julia and me are working since 3 years now. And the last is the one I'm doing with a colleague of mine, Frederik Schaaf, of the Ruhr University of Bochum, and we are trying to assess migration by using the agent-based modeling, so to understand different push-pull factors and reasons for migrations. So thank you for maybe I'll leave you this wonderful view from the Schiebeneck Museum. Thank you for your attention.